Hello, here we are at lesson two for week four, Monday the 11th, and our second lesson is reading and our focus writing on newspaper reports. So going into our reading, I'll just remind you very quickly, and I was so happy to see last week that we were sent another badge by the Epic Reading site to say that we have read over 250 books. So we seem to be clocking about 50 books a week. And I know that includes videos and read-alongs and comics, but it doesn't matter. As long as we keep accessing those resources and keep reading for at least 20 minutes a day or listening to stories that are being read, our reading's improving. So also please keep a little journal and write in there what you're reading for 20 minutes each day, and you can get dojo points for that. So today is the 11th, so if we have a look at the activity on our calendar from Epic Reading, it's favourite book on Epic Now, so you can read it later. So you choose a favourite book on Epic Reading site and you write why it's your favourite and you just slowly read through it and can read it later. Okay, so if we go into the reading activity for week four, it is this one here, which is to do with four characters in history who have made amazing achievements. Two of them are female and two of them are male, and this one down here, Amelia Earhart, she's particularly interesting, so we'll have a read of hers. So don't forget to head up your page Monday, week four, the 11th of May, and reading activity, and don't forget today is before reading, so please put that in. So we're going to have a quick look at those articles for first. We're going to skim and scan them. Then during reading, what we're going to infer about what we're reading, and after reading, questions. So I've sent you the reading for today, and I've done it up in a little bit of a easier to read format. So that's on Dojo for you. So if we just have a really put before reading in, and we'll have our quick skim and scan of the articles. There's two pages with four characters. So what do we think these articles are going to be about? What do we think we're going to learn from those? What do you think about how they're laid out? Do they look interesting? Do they have that topic up there straight away? So Siramavo Bandaranaike, I don't know who that is, but when I look straight up here, I can see she's the first female prime minister in modern history. So what do we think that information is going to be about? Amelia Earhart, here we have this lady, looks like she's got goggles, and we can see she's the first woman to fly solo across the Atlantic Ocean. We've got Haikam El Garouj. He looks like he's still alive, as we can see by his timeline. World history holder for running the fastest mile. And Edmund Hillary, first man to climb the summit of Mount Everest. So I've heard of this man and I've heard of this lady. And what you can do, one thing I will say about it is I think those images are terrible, even the colored ones. So if you wanted to put their name into Google and do a little bit of a search, I'm sure you'll find some better images of them and some information. So pause now and just write down some sentences for before reading, when you skimmed and scanned it, and what you thought. Okay, so head out up now during reading and let's go. So the first female prime minister in modern history, born 1916, died in 2000, Siramavo Bandaranaike. And if you go onto Google, as you know, and you can hit how to actually pronounce her name, which I'm sure I haven't done that good a job of. First female prime minister in modern history. I wonder with a name like that, what country she was prime minister of. Siramavo Bandaranaike was born in Sri Lanka. She was a member of the aristocracy, which means that coming down from the kings and the queens and the monarchies, upper class. In 1940, Bandaranaike married Solomon Bandaranaike, a member of parliament. He became prime minister of Ceylon, now Sri Lanka, in 1956. After her husband was shot dead in 1959, Siramavo became the leader of his political party. Wow, that's pretty interesting. So a married couple, and she's obviously helping him with all his duties and things like that, and he was shot and she stepped up and took his position. You wouldn't hear of that in Australia. She must have been extremely well known herself. Sirimo became the leader of her political party. She won an election in July 1960, so not only did she step up and take over, but she actually won an election as well, becoming the world's first female prime minister. Over time, her policies became unpopular. She was voted out of leadership in 1965, but was re-elected as prime minister in 1970. So she was voted out, but she didn't leave politics and came back in 1970, which is 50 years ago. She faced much criticism and was even accused of corruption. After delaying the election for 2 years, Baranaik's family lost the prime ministership in 1977 election. Despite retaining her seat, her daughter later became president of Sri Lanka. Now her daughter's president of Sri Lanka. Wow. Reinstating her mother as prime minister in 1994. If we drew a timeline of those events, that would be crazy. Baranaik held the position until August 2000. She died 2 months later of a heart attack, aged 84. So this family's history of being prime ministers and ruling Ceylon and then Sri Lanka in 1956 goes back to 1940 to 2000. That is 60 years. So in 1940... Her husband became prime minister. Then he was shot dead in 1959, which is 19 years later. Then she stepped up and took the leadership, but then she was voted in her own right in 1960. Then she was voted out in 65, but she was re-elected in 1970. Then she finally lost in 1977, which is another 7 years of being the prime minister. But she still retained her seat as an MP, a Member of Parliament. Then her daughter later became Prime Minister earlier, and then got her mother reinstated as Prime Minister in 1994, where she stayed until year 2000. That's an amazing story. Okay, Amelia Earhart, 1897 to 1939. She's the first woman to fly solo across the Atlantic Ocean. Amelia Earhart was an American aviator and author. In 1922, she became the first woman to fly a plane at an altitude of 14,000 feet. During her career, Earhart broke many records, demonstrating that women were worthy of being taken seriously in aviation. On the 20th of May 1932, Earhart had the honour of being the first woman to fly solo across the Atlantic Ocean. She vanished over the South Pacific in July 1937 while attempting to be the first woman to circumnavigate the globe by air. Authorities declared her dead in 1939. Wow, I wonder if there's a movie about that. Have a Google, see if you can find a movie about Amelia Earhart and let me know. That would be really interesting. Fancy vanishing out of the sky. Okay, now here our next character in history is Hicham El Gerouge, 1974, and he's still alive. The world record holder for running the fastest mile. Hicham El Gerouge was born in Morocco and was one of seven children. His father owned a small restaurant. The family used to make the young Hicham run a mile to the bakery to get bread and return before the bread was cold. At the age of 14, El Gerouge entered his first cross-country race. A year later, he left school and began training as a runner, participating in his first Olympic Games in 1996. El Gerouge fell over during his race, I remember that, and finished last. Despite this setback, his running achievements grew over the following years. In 1999, he broke the world record for the mile, 1.6 kilometre, running in just 3 minutes and 43 seconds. El Gerouge has used his fame for good, becoming a UNICEF, which is United Nations group that go together and try and improve the conditions of the sick and the poor in the world, Goodwill Ambassador in the same year. He is considered one of the greatest middle distance runners of all time. I bet you could go back and find YouTube of that race where he was running and fell over for sure. And our last character, Edmund Hillary, 1919 to 2008. There's definitely a movie about this. I think I've seen it. He's the first to climb the summit of Mount Everest. Edmund Hillary was a New Zealand explorer and mountaineer. Developing a love of climbing from a young age, he climbed his first major mountain at the age of 20. Accompanied by a Nepalese Sherpa, and Sherpas are the native people who live there that go up and down the mountains, and they're amazing. Google a picture of them. They've got this huge lung capacity where they can go up quite high and not be affected by the lack of oxygen at very high altitudes, and they can also carry very heavy packs. And it's really interesting when you see footage and photos of them, because these Sherpas are just wearing cotton pants and a hat and cotton shirts, and the explorers are all done up in all this thermo gear, and they get frostbite and die, and these Sherpas are so tough and conditioned to it they don't even seem to be affected by it. And mountaineer named Tenzing Norgay. Hillary reached the summit of Mount Everest, the tallest mountain in the world, on the 28th of May 1953. Hillary and Norgay battled high altitudes and a 12-meter rock wall, now known as Hillary's Step, to reach the summit. Hillary continued exploring later in life, joining expeditions to both the South and North Poles. He died of a heart failure in his hometown of Auckland, aged 88. So now what you need to do is go into after reading question. So during reading, you use clues from the text to make at least one inference about each of the famous people and write a list of your inferences. So what would be your inference about that Prime Minister, who, that lady who was there for 60 years and even though it was voted out, kept coming back? So she was really obsessed with politics and maintaining control of that country, wasn't she? And it'd be interesting to know how good a job she actually did. That would be worth Googling and see if she considered the right and was a humane leader, or whether she just wanted control. I bet you she was. And then something about the pilot, Amelia Earhart. What can you infer about her? She was pretty adventurous and ended up getting lost out there and vanished. Maybe her plane went down or something sadly happened. The runner, he was a good humanitarian person who lived a hard life and gave back to the people who gave him such a great career. And the last one is the climber. What can you infer about him? Okay, he lived a pretty exciting life too. Now, our after reading questions, list any questions you may have about these famous people that cannot be answered by reading the text, and research the answers to some of the questions. I didn't even know that was a question and I was telling you to do that. So, was she a good leader? Did she bring about some good changes for women and the poor people of the country? You know, why was she in power for so long? Amelia Earhart, what do they think happened to her when she was in the sky and vanished on that day? Did they ever find her plane? Haikam El Garouge, what did he do while he was the ambassador in UNICEF? How did he actually help people, the poor people? And Edmund Hillary, what can we say about him? How many times he attempted to climb Everest? Why did he want to climb Everest? Okay, so there's some questions for you that you can put in. All right, now if we go to our focus writing for this week, and there's the original text that was in the pack. If we go to our focus writing, we'll see that last week we did this one. This week, this one's attached to it and is lesson four. And then for week four, they've actually got in there that it's lesson six. So what we're going to do is we're going to knock over lesson four today, and then we're going to do lesson six tomorrow. And if you need, I can send you those documents and things for you to use. Okay, so if we open up lesson four, we're just going to work our way through it. If you're doing it in a book, please head up your book with your name, week four, Monday the 11th of May 2020, and we'll work through that now. Okay, I'll make this a little bit bigger. Okay, So today we're going to understand how news reports represent ideas and events in specific ways, which means that they're just written for a specific purpose of explaining what's happened to us. Understand that complex sentences are used to combine details of issues and events in news reports. Now, you know what a complex sentence is, but if you're not sure, if you go into this sentence styles PowerPoint here, it will explain to you compound sentences. That was an activity we did in our spelling, which is using but, and, so, or, yet, or for. And a complex sentence is when you're using more complex joining words such as therefore, although, since, and there's a whole heap of them you can do, but basically joining two sentences that you would otherwise have as one. Okay, but there's the PowerPoint there and you can have a quick look at that. So that's what you're doing, you're understanding that you can, and in year six that is a must. Okay, you have to write using compound and complex sentences. The resources are Sharp Fins Behind the News transcript, which you used in lesson one, news journal that you're writing in, or your exercise book. Okay, so today we'll learn about the purpose of television news reports and their features, and we have lots to explore, so let's begin. So we've done radio, news reports over the radio, and now we're going to do television. If you don't have this sheet in front of you, if you want to, you can write some notes down in your book. A television news report uses visuals and audios to represent the most up-to-date newsworthy informations to viewers. So the big bonus is that you get the visual and you get the images and you get the written information. It covers topics of human interest and general information that affects lives of their viewers. There are many advantages and disadvantages of television news reports. An example of each has been provided in the table below, and you're going to write one more advantage and one more disadvantage. So television news reports are visibly stimulating and attention grabbing is one advantage. And can you think of another advantage of watching the TV on the news? If you're more of a visual learner, you get to see all the images. If you're more of an audio learner, you get to hear it as well. And if you record it, you can replay it, I suppose. A disadvantage is the full details of the story may not be provided due to time constraints. And another disadvantage might be depending which news station you watch, it could be very biased. It could be the news station telling the reporters how to show the story rather than the facts. So you have to be careful of that. So we're going to sheet four, Shark Fins Behind the News transcript, which is a television news report. And we're using the Q&R strategy to answer the following questions. Now, if you've forgotten what a Q&R strategy is, which is understandable because we've looked at a lot of things, I can send you this as well if you want. A Q&R strategy is the way that you read the text or you listen to the text and how you think and search for the information that you need. And you're doing this through a combination of using the information that the author's given you and what you already know. So a really quick image for it is this one here, which I really like, is a question answer relationship. That's what Q&R means. And the information obviously is right there in the text or in the book. So when you're asked a question about it or you ask yourself a question, you go straight back into it and you find the information in there. You think and you search and you put it together. It's also in your head. So I always say this, you never pick something up and just read it completely independently as though you know nothing about it. Soon as you read something, whether you're aware of it or not, you're linking it to information that you already know and experiences that you already have. And that's really important that you do that so that you can get a deeper understanding of what you've read. So if you want me to send this to you, I can, but this is what these lessons really focus on. So you're using the information from the author, you're searching for information in the text, and you're also linking it to what you know yourself. And you're constantly going back into the text and finding it. Okay. So so if we have a look at that shark fin questions, which looks like we might need to read the transcript from lesson one. And here it is here. So this was a conversation between Robert Stewart, the director, who's talking about sharks and his perspective about it, so behind the news. So just the other week, and I've read that to you in week one, so I don't think I'll go through that now and read it to you. You can pause it in different screens and have a read of it now if you want. And Sarah Larson was the reporter. And this was on the news. So although it's there as a transcript, it actually happened visually on the news. They crossed, cut across to it and they watched it, okay? And behind the news is the Kids ABC news show. I wonder if we could find that on YouTube. I should have had a look for that. Okay, so if we go back into the lesson, the questions that they're asking you about that text is, how does Robert, the director of Shark Water, want people to see sharks? So does he want them to see, does he want people to see sharks as big man-eating killers, or does he want people to understand that they are living in their territory and they're not really causing that much damage and they are actually being hunted? What's the perspective? Then, so that information's right there. It jumps right out at you. Then you think and search information. Why did filming for his movie in the Galapagos Island make Rob Stewart angry and sad? So find that information. The author in me, so you're working with the author of the story, the reporter, and you're going to put forward the audience perspective. So what is the audience persuaded to believe about sharks? And on your own understanding from what you know, how do news reports attempt to persuade readers with particular points of view? Okay, you can pause me while you fill those in. Okay, television news and radio news are both examples of spoken news reports. They follow the same text structure, but they are different. There are differences about how the report is presented to the audience. So list the text structures used in a news report. And at this stage, we're going to flick over to this little one there that I really like. And that gives you the structure of a news report, so you can use that to fill out those boxes. So don't forget, headline at the top, catchy when you read it, and it's usually a bit of a play on words. Stanley Seagull kidnapped from out the front of shops. It grabs your attention, you know sort of what it's about, and you go, oh, that's interesting. Then you've got your summary or your lead paragraph, your who, what, when, where, why, and your how. And it gives you the caption with most of that information that you need. And then your body has all the detail in it. And then the tail end of the news report is the least important information, and it usually has limited space. And don't forget, it's an inverted triangle. This is the most important part of it up here. So even if you pause that while you write that down, or fill in the sheet that you're for the lesson today. So here it is here, and you just put those categories in there. You don't have to go into a lot of detail. So your headline, your lead, your body, and your tail. Okay, compare the table below, complete the table below to describe two similarities and two differences between television and radio news reports. So what are two similarities between a television news and a radio news? So you can hear the information. They usually give you a lot of details and facts about it because it's audio based information. The differences are, of course, on the TV you get the visuals as well, and for a radio they might have longer interviews to try and give you more information about it. Okay, so television news has the advantage of including features such as images, captions, graphs, charts and tables to help you understand the story. And then they tell you what these things are. Explore complex sentences in news reports. You have now been able to identify different text structures in spoken news reports, so the difference between TV news and radio news, that's what they're talking about. And we've looked at some of these language features used in these reports. Let's now revise clauses and sentence types. So when they say that we've looked at some of those language features, the language features that they're talking about is the tone of the news article. So is it a really angry one? Is it a sympathetic one? Is it sad? Then their formal language, or are they using slang? How they're describing it, if they're being factual, Are they being biased? They're some of the language features that they're talking about. So now they're telling us to look at some clauses. So a clause, there are two main types of clauses, main and subordinate. So a main clause contains a subject and a verb. So it's like a simple sentence, okay, and can stand alone. As a sentence, it can stand alone as a sentence, and it makes sense. We drive to town on Saturday. So that is a main clause, and it's also a simple sentence. A subordinate clause contains a subject and a verb, but it cannot stand alone as a sentence because it doesn't make sense on its own. So because we need to buy groceries. So this is almost, so you've got the simple sentence, which is your main clause, and then you've got your bit that you put in after your compound or your complex word, that is your subordinate. So it's not a sentence on its own, it just adds extra information to the sentences. Then it goes on to say, there are three different types of sentences, simple, compound, and complex, we know that. So this one, as we just said, your simple one is your main, and your compound or your complex is your subordinate because it's adding more information there. So a simple sentence has one main clause, for example, I walked my dog this morning, and a compound sentence has two main clauses joined by a coordinating conjunction, such as, and, but, or. For example, I walked my dog this morning and she barked at a cyclist. A complex sentence has a main clause and at least one subordinate clause that gives more information about the main clause. The clauses are linked by words such as because, which, while, and each idea has a verb, for example. The cyclist did not see the problem, which, there's your complex joiner, was unfortunate. There's your main clause, there's your subordinate clause. So, we're going to write the main clause and subordinate clauses in this sentence. Because their numbers are dwindling, sharks must be protected. So which part of that sentence makes the most sense and which part makes the least sense? Now they've tried to trick us by switching it around. If I said sharks must be protected, is that a sentence in itself? Even though it doesn't start with a capital? Yes, it is. So that's your main clause. Because their numbers are dwindling, that's just more information. It's not a complete sentence on its own, so it becomes a subordinate clause. Okay, in this sentence, you will notice that a comma has been used to separate the clauses. If a subordinate clause occurs at the beginning of a sentence, you need to use a comma before the main clause. So all they're saying there, if a subordinate clause occurs at the beginning, so if there is a part of a sentence that doesn't make sense on its own, you need to put a comma there to pause so that you can give it the main clause that does make sense, okay? Because I fell out of bed this morning, comma, I went and had a big coffee to wake up. Okay, so I went and had a big coffee to wake up. That's your whole sentence on its own that makes sense. That's your main clause. And because I fell out of bed this morning, I wouldn't recommend starting a sentence with because anyway. It is not good writing technique. Okay, there's other ways you can do that. Okay, we're on to the last page. We've nearly finished lesson four. Rewrite the sentences below in your English exercise book using a comma to separate the clauses. So since it is a rich resource, we must protect the ocean. So which part of that sentence made sense on its own? We must protect the ocean. And because it started off with a subordinate clause first, we put a comma in there. She loves dolphins. While sharks terrify her. This time they've got the main clause here. While sharks terrify her is the subordinate clause, so we don't need a comma there. You only need a comma when you start with the subordinate clause. Okay, and we know that authors can be innovative with sentences and structures and can rearrange them. And as long as you understand the basic grammar of how a sentence works, you can be very creative with your writing, but you must go back and read it to make sure that it makes sense. Okay. And that's it for today. Yeah, that's it. So we finished lesson four. Now, when you go into Edge Studio, if you do go and have a look, you will see that They've got, under focus writing, they've got 3B, which was lesson four. And when we jump in and do lesson four tomorrow, week four tomorrow, it goes to lesson six. Don't worry about it. Okay, so today we did lesson four. There's no lesson five. And then tomorrow we'll do lesson six, which will split up over a couple of days. All right, well, I hope that's helped. And don't forget to have a look at these parts on here, holding text together, the things that you need. And that's it, and I shall see you for maths, closing down everything.